Coming up on the show, Azure Analysis Services is a proven analytics engine to connect and analyze disparate data sources, whether you're on premises or in the cloud, without having to manage your own infrastructure. We're going to take a look at how you can gain insights from your data using Analysis Services' semantic model, the speed of in-memory processing and querying of your enterprise data sets, and migrating your on-prem data models to the cloud. I'm joined today by Josh Caplan from the Azure Analysis Services team. Welcome.
Yeah, thank you, great to be here.
So you recently announced the preview of Azure AS, and really it joins a spectrum of technologies for data management and business insights, but what's your team trying to solve for?
So Azure Analysis Services is built on top of Analysis Services, which is a proven technology that we've shipped along with SQL Server for many years now. And what it does, it lets you take all that data that you have in your databases, your data warehouses, and then take all that business knowledge, that business logic you have, and you can combine it together into a semantic model to give access to your business users to go query the data. Not only can they query that data in the semantic model, but they can query it very fast because you have this very fast in-memory cache. So we've taken that product, and now we've moved it to the cloud as a fully managed platform as a service in Azure.
And now it's a lot different these days because we've got a lot of disparate data that not only lives on-premises, whether it's in something like SQL or Oracle or databases, but we're also getting a lot of data that's going natively to the cloud with things like IoT devices, intelligent devices. So bringing it all together into a single semantic model at scale with all the speed that you're talking about is pretty significant, but how does it work?
Well, let me show you. So here we are, we're actually in the Power BI desktop and we're connected to a semantic model. And the data for this model actually came from lots of places, literally a bunch of cabs, all the cabs in New York City.
And those cabs are kind of like IoT devices in and of themselves, right?
Yeah, they're collecting the data where they picked up their customers, how long the trips were, what they spent on each trip. And then we've kind of taken that data, we've aggregated it all together, mm-hmm. and we put it into a SQL data warehouse. Okay. And we built a semantic model on top of that data warehouse, and we've pulled that data into our cache. So what you see here is not the data warehouse, but what you see is the semantic model. So everything's in business-friendly terms. So if I want to do something like, what were the number of trips, I can easily figure out how to do that query by going into trips, and I can just see trip count. I can drag that onto our canvas here. And what you saw there is we actually just ran a query against all the data that we have on our trips.
And 2 billion.
Yeah, so we scanned just over 2 billion rows there in what was that, a fraction of a second.
Yep.
So some advantages you have when the data is that quick is you can ask all kinds of questions of it and get answers. So let's do some more analysis of this data. Let's actually see where are all the trips happening from. Okay. So let's put our location fields on here with all the pickup locations for every cab ride in New York.
Okay.
And it's New York, so there's lots of cabs and there's lots of rides.
And lots of data, and you just queried it in seconds.
And lots of data that we just queried and we plotted every single point there.
Okay.
So let's do a little bit more analysis because right now we have a lot of points. So let's see where are the most popular places to pick up rides. And where are the most profitable if we're a cab driver, right?
Right.
So let's look at actually the revenue per trip, like how much money we're making on each trip on average. And let's look at it by the different pickup locations. Pick up zip codes in this case. So in New York, there are two zip codes that have many more pickups than others. You have any idea what those might be?
Every time I go to New York, I'm using cabs at the airport. I'm guessing there are the two main airports.
Well, let's see. We can click on them. We'll actually run another query in here that'll filter down the map to just show the data that's in this point here.
Okay.
And you're right, that's JFK Airport.
Right.
And we click on the other one, that would be LaGuardia Airport. And you can see lots of people picking up rides and also lots of people waiting on the highway to actually get their ride.
Now,
I guess it's busy there.
Right. If I'm one of the numerous cab drivers and want to figure out should I be going to JFK or LaGuardia, how do I do that?
Well, looking at the chart here, you can see that you can actually make more money per trip on average from JFK than LaGuardia. But let's just see how that holds up when we ask some more questions about the data. So let's actually look at the average length of those trips and how many are in those lengths. So let's look at the trip count again. And this time we're gonna look at it by the trip duration. And we're gonna bucket them by that. And we switch this around so everything fits. So now when I click on JFK, we're gonna run our queries against that model. And you see that most of the trips to JFK are 30 to 45 minutes.
It's pretty long.
It is pretty long. And we go to LaGuardia, it's actually way more of the trips are 15 to 30 minutes.
Much closer to the city, right?
Yeah, definitely. So the amount of money you make per trip is very close. It's a little bit more at JFK. But at LaGuardia, you can actually get more trips in. So If I had to say, I would say I would go to LaGuardia if I was a driver, and I could do more trips with about the same amount of revenue.
So we'll see if Microsoft Mechanics changes taxi driver behavior watching this. So it's really significant, especially in the terms of the volume of data that's being processed, because we just showed 2 billion rows of data there. So I know a lot of people are probably running SQL Server Analysis Services. How does AAS compare to that?
So this is kind of a typical topology you would see for someone running analysis services. They'd have their data sources. They have SQL Server. They have even third-party data sources like Oracle and Teradata. Mm-hmm. Then they'd pick another server, and they'd run analysis services on it, and they can connect to it to things like Excel and SQL Server Management Studio, Visual Studio. So very similar in Azure Analysis Services, but what we do is you take that analysis services piece that was running on a server, and now you move that up to Azure. It's in our platform as a service. And you can leave your data sources on-premise if you want. We can still connect to those same Oracle databases through what we call a gateway, go all the way down to on-prem and connect to those sources.
Okay.
Or you can move those sources up to the cloud and put them in things like Azure SQL Database, Azure SQL Data Warehouse, and now you have a full end-to-end data solution in the cloud.
Right, and because it's cloud-based, you don't have to worry about maintaining the physical servers that you would have done on-prem, right?
Right, so if your data grows and you don't have to go out and buy a bigger server, you just go a couple clicks and you have more capacity.
So does anything change then when I move from on-prem into Azure Analysis Services?
We spend a lot of time to make sure that we had compatibility, the same compatibility that we have on-prem in the cloud. So mm-hmm. SQL Server Management Studio, SQL Server Data Tools, Excel, Power BI, all those still continue to work in both places.
So how do I get all of this then up and running?
Well, like anything in Azure, or most things in Azure, it starts in the Azure portal. Okay. I can come in here and I can click New, and under Intelligence and Analytics,
right. You'll
find the preview for Azure Analysis Services.
Okay.
You can click on that. You name your server. And these are logical servers. Just like other resources in Azure, I can go pick my resource group. And I can pick my location. We have lots of locations to choose from. If you have employees all over the world and you want to get your data kind of co-located with them, you don't have to go build a data center in their regions. You can use Azure. Azure is all over the world, and so is Azure Analysis Services. We're in lots of regions now, and we're going to continue to add more. Mm-hmm. And the last thing you have to pick is your pricing tier. The way it's priced is it's basically you pick different tiers based on the size of your data and how many users you think you're going to have concurrently querying it.
Okay.
So that taxi data we showed is pretty big.
Big model, yeah.
It was 2 billion rows in just a single table there.
Right.
More than 2 billion. So we're going to pick the biggest one here. I'll select that. And we'll go ahead and we'll say create.
So that's going to go up and spin up a server or AAS to connect to data sources. But we haven't defined all those things yet. So the taxi model that we saw was something that you might have created in SSAS. Can I move that model then and bring that up into Azure Analysis Services?
Yeah, so what you do is once the server's created, ours is still going, it takes about 5 minutes. You can come in here and you can grab that server name.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can go into SQL Server Data Tools. This is where you build your models. So here is that model I showed you earlier in the demo. This is our taxi data. Mm-hmm. And it's connecting to a SQL data warehouse, but you don't see the data warehouse here. You see your semantic model.
Right.
Those are the friendly table names, friendly columns. And you also see the relationships between the table. Mm-hmm. This is how I was able to go just click on fields from different tables, and it automatically knew how to join it all together because that metadata is here in this model.
Right.
In addition to just relationships, calculations are in here. So remember how I just said, give me the trip count. Well, we can build those calculations in using the same query language you use in Analysis Services, and it's also the same query language you use in Power BI. It's our DAX query language. So here you're looking at revenue per mile, which is a pretty simple calculation. It's just showing revenue divided by the trip distance. Mm-hmm. But you can make these as advanced as you want. DAX is a very, very powerful language.
Yeah, one tip if you're new to Power BI, you're going to want to learn DAX querying. How easy is it, though, to target the new AAS environment for your model?
So we copied our server name earlier. All I have to do here is come into the project, go into the properties, and under deployment server, you see the server name. This was pointing to my desktop before on premise. All I have to do is change it to the server we just created. And I can say OK. Finally, just come in, hit deploy, and that's it. It'll go push it right up to the cloud.
And that's all you're doing. You're just changing the target path from your on-prem server into the online server effectively. What if I'm a big enterprise and I've got thousands or hundreds of thousands of data models, maybe not hundreds of thousands, but tens of thousands, how would I do that and automate it?
So this is Azure now. And like other Azure services, you can automate everything in there. So you can use the Azure ARM APIs, you can use ARM templates, you can go and you can automate creating those thousand servers if you want to. Something you wouldn't easily do on-prem. And then you can also use the APIs that come with analysis services to automate the deployments of the models and the management of the models, even the processing, updating that cache, keeping it up to date. All that can be automated.
So to sum up what we just saw, AAS is really easy to get started with. You can use your favorite tools to visualize, whether it's Power BI, Excel, et cetera, to analyze that data. Where else can people go, though, to learn more and get really deep on this topic?
Well, you can click the link below to get started. The service is in public preview, so anyone can use it. And please give us feedback. This is really what we use to drive the product and decide what we're going to do next.
It's a really great overview. Thanks for joining us today, Josh. And of course, you can keep watching and checking back to Microsoft Mechanics for all the latest in tech updates across Microsoft. Thank you all for watching, and we'll see you next time.